A couple of weeks ago, I posted a video about product placement in the 1990 movie Total Recall, and for this video we're continuing with the same subject with regards to the movie Pulp Fiction. The dynamics of how each film approaches the issue of product placement are very, very different, and we'll get deep into that stuff in a minute. But before we continue, I just want to say that the cheeky stunt that I pulled in the Total Recall video of advertising my digital download videos with satirical overkill as a demonstration of advertising techniques is not something I'm going to repeat here. I promise I won't advertise my website collativelearning.com and my offline videos until the very end of this video. Promise, cross my heart, with sugar on top, hope to die, etc, blah blah blah. So let's get on with the fun stuff. Alright, so a big factor that sets Pulp Fiction apart from almost every other movie is that it very overtly mocks product placement. It first does this in the second scene of the film, Jules and Vincent chatting about Europe. Now this scene was great when the movie came out for the mere fact that the characters were talking about things that had nothing to do with the core plot of the movie. It created a casual feeling of everyday realism. It also was interesting because it brought elements of international cultural awareness to the audience, something a lot of movies set in the US don't do.
You know what they put on french fries in Holland instead of ketchup? What? Mayonnaise?
Yeah, as far as I know, that's true. We do it here in the UK. Not all the time. Some use ketchup, some use mayo, but you get the point. Now, mixed in with all that dialogue about Europe is a lengthy reference to McDonald's.
And in Paris, you can buy beer at McDonald's. And you know what they call a quarter pounder with cheese in Paris?
And what do they call it?
They call it Royale with cheese.
Royale with cheese.
That's right.
What do they call a Big Mac?
Big Mac's a Big Mac, but they call it Le Big Mac.
On the one hand, this McDonald's dialogue is so overt it comes off as a joke, and it may well just be a joke. However, there are a few things that make me suspect it might actually have been a paid product placement. The positive regard the characters have for the French names of McDonald's burgers.
They call it Royale with cheese.
Royale with cheese.
That's right.
A Le Big Mac.
The insulting dismissal of the company Burger King, which is probably the key rival of McDonald's.
What do they call a Whopper?
I don't know, I didn't go on a Burger King.
And the fact that McDonald's was very prominently product placed in this deleted scene from Tarantino's previous movie, Reservoir Dogs. Notice how the blonde, cute girl dressed in sexy red matches the colours of the McDonald's sign, as if the scene is saying that McDonald's is kinda sexy. You don't get a major brand name logo into shot like that purely by accident when making a major movie. Now that one could have been a joke too, but in this interview Tarantino confesses that for both Reservoir Dogs and Pulp Fiction, he and the producers had approached the diner chain Denny's in the hope of selling them product placement. But Denny's said no due to the violence in the scripts. It could even be that because the McDonald's product placement in Reservoir Dogs was cut from the final film, Tarantino and crew may have compensated McDonald's with the overt promotion of their brand as an international chain in Pulp Fiction. Now, whether McDonald's paid for this or not, the scene still comes off as a joke on product placement. The satirical overkill of brand names carries on in other scenes too. A major one is the scene where Vincent buys heroin from Lance. The cola brand Pepsi gets a mention. And listen carefully.
This is the house they come to. Now my shit, I'll take the Pepsi challenge with that Amsterdam shit any old day of the fucking week.
That's a bold statement.
This ain't Amsterdam, Vince. This is a seller's market. Coke is fucking dead as dead. Heroin is coming back in a big fucking way.
Pepsi challenge, Coke is dead, Coca-Cola is dead. Doesn't that seem like a bit of a coincidence in terms of brand rivalry, like with the McDonald's versus Burger King dialogue earlier? Now, in case you think that's all coincidence and that Pepsi is the only brand referenced in this scene, listen to this bit of dialogue from the final scene of the movie.
Vincent, don't you see that shit don't matter? You're judging this shit the wrong way. I mean, it could be God stopped the bullets, or he changed Coke to Pepsi, he found my fucking car keys. You don't judge shit like this based on merit.
Snap. We got another example of brand rivalry with Pepsi coming out as the winner. Unless Tarantino has a definite personal preference for Pepsi, my money is on both of these Pepsi versus Coke scenes being instances of paid product placement. But again, Tarantino is doing something that other movies tend not to do. He makes the product placement into a joke, and I quite like that. I mean, if a filmmaker can fulfill their product placement obligation in a way that's entertaining, then all power to him. Right, so that's two major instances of tongue-in-cheek product placements, with each example featuring a sneaky attack on a major rival brand. Something that's interesting about that is it's possible that the concept of attacking a rival brand like that may have been something that Tarantino or his producers presented to a couple of these major brands, and they lapped it up and went, yeah, we'll take some of that. Now, in studying the whole film scene by scene and looking for brands, I noticed something that surprised me. A lot of scenes feature no brand names at all, even though we'd expect to see at least some incidental brands in those scenarios. Take the diner location, which is in the first and last scene of the movie. I see no specific brand names, no ketchup bottles with visible labels or anything like that. Okay, some diners and cafes use their own sauce containers and so on, but Marcellus's bar, the pawn shop, and even the kitchen in Jimmy's house, there are hardly any prominent brand names or logos. So it looks like there's been a bit of a conscious effort not to feature brand names in these sets. And even here, the culinary items on the cooker are all turned away so that the labels aren't visible. A refrigerator brand is hardly readable too, so it looks like that one was incidental and unavoidable. However, this execution scene also does something else regarding brand names that's very unusual in movies. It promotes a non-existent brand name. A fake fast food brand called Big Kahuna is advertised to us in visual and dialogue overkill.
Looks like me and Vincent caught you boys at breakfast. Sorry about that. What you having?
Hamburgers.
Hamburgers! The cornerstone of any nutritious breakfast. What kind of hamburgers?
Cheeseburgers.
No. Where'd you get them? McDonald's, Wendy's, Jack in the Box, where?
Big Kahuna Burger.
Big Kahuna Burger? That's that Hawaiian burger joint. I hear they got some tasty burgers. I ain't never had one myself. How are they?
They're good.
You mind if I try one of yours? Mm-hmm. This is a tasty burger. Vincent, you ever had a Big Kahuna Burger? Want a bite? They're real tasty.
Ain't hungry.
Well, if you like burgers, give them a try sometime.
Now, here's the weird thing. Is Tarantino just mocking product placement, or has he used his sharp scriptwriting skills to create an extremely smart piece of product placement for McDonald's? We already had the promotion of McDonald's over its main rival in the car scene earlier on. Now, in this scene. If it had been McDonald's burgers being directly promoted, then there would likely have been a critical and consumer backlash against the scene. So instead, the audience are confused by being presented with a brand name that they've never heard of before, Big Kahuna. But McDonald's is twice referenced verbally in this scene.
What kind of hamburgers?
Cheeseburgers.
No. Where'd you get them? McDonald's, Wendy's, Jack in the Box. I do love the taste of a good burger. Mmm. You know what they call a quarter pound of a cheese in France?
No.
Tell them, Vincent.
Royale with cheese.
Royale with cheese.
Now, it seems to me that the verbal promotion of McDonald's is very cleverly disguised here, being that three real fast food chains are mentioned by name, but the fact that he mentions McDonald's first is in itself a kind of promotion. It suggests that McDonald's is the first option go-to for fast food burger products.
No. Where'd you get them? McDonald's, Wendy's, Jack in the Box, where?
Big Kahuna Burger.
And remember that in the car, Burger King were dismissed as irrelevant?
What do they call a Whopper?
I don't know, I didn't go on a Burger King.
And here, Burger King don't even get a mention in that list. Now, to my knowledge, Burger King is a bigger and more well-known brand than Wendy's or Jack in the Box, so their exclusion from Jules' brand name list is almost like another snub to that brand, as if they're so far down they're not even on the map. And about that non-existent brand name burger we see, I'd put money on it that the food prop is actually a McDonald's quarter pounder. It certainly isn't a Burger King Whopper considering the absence of lettuce. Or it might be a Big Mac, Big Kahuna, Big Mac, get it? As for the second dialogue reference to McDonald's, Jules talks about how tasty the so-called Big Kahuna burger is, and then, while still eating it, brings up the subject of quarter pounder burgers in France. He doesn't mention the word McDonald's, but we know from the earlier dialogue that that's the brand name he means. And he talks with glee about the burger name Royale with Cheese.
Tell him, Vincent.
Royale with Cheese.
Royale with Cheese. You know why they call it that?
Now, if McDonald's did pay for this piece of product placement, then maybe they wanted the audience to subconsciously rename the quarter pounders with the name Royale because it sounds more flattering to the product. So is the brand name Big Kahuna just a stand-in metaphor to promote McDonald's? Perhaps another clue to that effect is that though the drink carton says Big Kahuna, Brett says it contains Sprite, and that's another real brand name.
What's in this?
Sprite.
Sprite, good. You mind if I have some of your tasty beverage to wash this down?
Go right ahead.
And Jules is shown drinking it all down and enjoying it. It's a clear promotion of Sprite being supposedly tasty.
That hit the spot.
Far too sweet for me personally, but again the product promotion is disguised by the Big Kahuna label on the cup. Now if you go to McDonald's and have a Coke, you tend to actually get Coke written on the cup. If this fast food sequence is all just one big product placement for McDonald's and Sprite, then it's one of the best pieces of subliminal advertising I've ever seen. It's deceptive due to the fake brand name, it's funny, and given the tension of the scene in terms of inevitable violence, it's dramatic and stimulating. And by having the tough, smart gangster be the one who eats, drinks, and enjoys the products, there's a carried identity implication. Tough, smart, streetwise men eat fast food, which is actually garbage. It is possible, though, that the whole sequence really is just a joke and not actually a paid product placement, and I say that for two other reasons. Firstly, the discussion of fast food is such an arbitrary and everyday occurrence that it gives a feeling of normality to scenes that otherwise could be taken as being over the top in terms of contrived dramatics. It absolutely works on that level. But also I suspect the McDonald's Big Kahuna stuff might be a big joke because there are other fake brands in Pulp Fiction that don't seem to be promoting any real brands. For example, there are no real-world cigarette brands in the movie, even though lots of characters are seen smoking. In every instance I looked at, if there was a cigarette brand name made visible, then it turned out to be a fictional one called Red Apples.
Could you, roll me one of those, cowboy?
You can have this one, cowgirl.
A pack of red apples.
Build this.
None. The Jackrabbit Slim's Diner is a false location and brand name made up for the movie. A fake cab company called Big Jerry is seen here. Apparently that's based on a guy called Jerry who was a friend of Tarantino. And the fictional Monster Joe's has a logo on a vehicle in the background here. It takes a bit of effort to set up all these fake brands. And in Butcher's apartment he grabs a packet of Sam's toaster pastries. As far as I know, that's a fake brand. Maybe Pop-Tarts weren't willing to cough up to have their product in the movie, and so the filmmakers took the approach of, well, if you don't pay, then we'll just substitute you with a fake brand. Another set of scenes that have some of these elements we've explored is the hilarious scenes in Jimmy's house where characters discuss coffee.
God damn, Jimmy. This is some serious gourmet shit. Me and Vincent would have been satisfied with some freeze-dried Taster's Choice, right? And he springs this serious gourmet shit on us. What flavor is this?
Knock it off, Julie.
What?
I don't need you to tell me how fucking good my coffee is, okay? I'm the one who buys it. I know how good it is. When Bonnie goes shopping, she buys shit. I buy the gourmet expensive stuff because when I drink it, I want to taste it.
Do me a favor, will you? Don't let smell some coffee back there. Would you make me a cup?
Taster's Choice is the only real brand that gets mentioned there, so maybe that was a paid product placement. But then maybe not, being that it's implied that there's an expensive gourmet brand that's well worth the extra dollar. It's also implied that cheaper coffee brands are the equivalent of shit, which isn't flattering to Taster's Choice. But also, Taster's Choice is just one of many Nescafe brands. I don't drink coffee, but I assume that they have some gourmet brands too. Now I've emailed about five of the companies whose brands are featured in Pulp Fiction and I've asked them if the appearances of their brands were done with consent, paid or not, and what they think of how their products are depicted in the movie. Funnily enough, the only responses I managed to get were ones telling me that I needed to email a different department, but once I did email the correct department, no response. No, that's not surprising really. I mean, the whole point of product placement is to sneak past the audience's conscious awareness, so it doesn't pay to advertise that you've done that. Okay, now, another facet of all these featured brands is the possibility that the film is, at times, subtly drawing attention to how unhealthy some of those foods are. Jules sarcastically states that fast food chain burgers are healthy, but we all know that they're not.
Hamburgers.
Hamburgers! the cornerstone of any nutritious breakfast.
The complete absence of real cigarette brand names could have been a conscientious one. Cigarettes are incredibly unhealthy. I mean, how many professional athletes are smokers? How many professional boxers are smokers? The fictional Red Apples brand name has an interesting graphic to that effect as well. A green worm with a human head is emerging from an apple and smoking a cigarette. Green faces in cartoons are often used to connote sickness. And we could take the red apple as being the burning Adam's apple in the throat of the smoker. In other words, the worm might represent a smoker's neck on fire. Well, you tell me what the hell this graphic means. The comparison of Pepsi and Coke to Class A drugs might be an underhanded critique as well. Coca-Cola is historically reported to have used cocaine as an ingredient before it became illegal. And both products tend to be marketed with regards to the sugar and caffeine highs that they offer. Pepsi Max? Maximum what? Maximum rush? Maximum high? In 1988, Coke carried a tagline, "You can't beat the feeling." What? Not even with a snort of cocaine? In some historical contexts, caffeine has been banned as a recreational drug, and until 2003 it was banned from international sports by the World Anti-Doping Agency. Some are now arguing for it to be reintroduced. And recently in the UK, the Advertising Standards Agency banned advertising of high salt, fat and sugar products in children's media. Caffeine and sugar give mild highs, and they're both addictable. They're drugs. Okay, so lots of conflicting information about which brand names featured in Pulp Fiction were product placements, if any, and what Tarantino's attitude to product placement is. It seems to me that he part embraces it as a means of funding his movies, but I think he also has some moral disagreements with it as a practice. In the interview where he confessed to having approaching the food chain Denny's with an offer of product placements in Reservoir Dogs and for Pulp Fiction, but that they refused, he mentions that he used to eat in Denny's a lot when he was younger, so the joint ended up being in his script a lot. The fact that Denny's doesn't appear in either film suggests that he avoided even showing an incidental Denny's in order to avoid legal objections by the food chain. So that in turn points to the notion that other brand names in his first two movies were either paid product placements or at the very least were done with permission of said companies. And that says something in itself. But it's difficult to know. I mean, take this scene. Two products get a mention.
Okay. Hey, fuck, nigga, what the fuck you just doing with the towel, man?
I was drying my hands.
Well, you're supposed to wash them first.
Well, you watched me wash them.
I watched you get them wet.
I was washing them. This shit's hard to get off. Maybe if you had lava, I could have done a better job.
I used the same fucking soap you did, and when I finished the towel, it looked like no goddamn maxi pad. Now what if you used to come in here and see a towel like this, Vincent?
So it's implied here that Lava Soap, which is a specific company brand, is more effective than regular soap. Though washing blood isn't the most glamorous context for its promotion. Had a rough shift at the abattoir? Are you covered in blood from pigs, cows and chickens? Then use Lava Soap. Lava Soap's special chemical formula breaks down dried up blood in all domestic cleanup situations. Lava Soap has been used by some of the bloodiest serial killers in history, from Jeffrey Dahmer to Dennis Nilsen. Order a batch online now and receive a signed Jeffrey Dahmer I Love Lava postcard. It doesn't work, does it? But even more unflattering in this scene is the depiction of maxi pads as a bloodstained rag. No, if you're going to advertise a hygiene product, you show the product in its pre-use state only. We don't see excrement-stained paper in toilet roll ads, do we? No, we see puppies because everyone knows that wiping your ass on a puppy is much more pleasant. But having said all that, I personally believe that negative context endorsing can work pretty damn well. An advert may meet with the viewer's conscious disapproval, but as long as it sets up the right associational triggers in their brains, then it does the job. In 1939, Coca-Cola used a lengthy tagline that hits the nail on the head. It stated, "Whoever you are, whatever you do, wherever you may be, when you think of refreshment, think of ice-cold Coca-Cola." The point is to get you to think about the product as much as possible, and especially within the context where you'll be more inclined to buy it. Another way of thinking about it is to recognise that major politically dividing events frequently cause more people to buy guns. When Donald Trump got elected, gun sales increased, at least that's what was reported in the media. Actually, I think that would have happened with Hillary too. In such circumstances, people aren't buying guns because they saw an advert with flowers coming out of a gun barrel. So news media negatively encourages product awareness and buying behaviour all the time, and sometimes even in cooperation with said companies, adverts disguised as news. That's a lot more common than most people realise. The overkill advertising approach, though it annoys a lot of people, works too. How many people enjoy being advertised to by Coke or Pepsi? Not many, I'll bet. Yet they still buy the products. So it could be that even Tarantino's mockery of product placements and his hints that some products are unhealthy may have still resulted in an overall promotion. I'll bet some people were prompted to go eat at McDonald's after leaving the movie theatre. And how many people, after seeing Pulp Fiction, asked their friends if they knew of a local Big Kahuna restaurant that they could go try out? We didn't all have the internet back then, so you couldn't just check online. How many people inquired as to whether they could go to visit the real Jackrabbit Slim's restaurant? If those brands actually existed, they'd have likely gotten a huge profitable boost by Pulp Fiction. There's a general assumption among a lot of advertising professionals that sneaking your product into people's awareness is becoming the much better approach to take rather than ham-fisted overkill. There are some notable arguments to that effect, such as people switching off to obvious advertising in the age of information overload. Personally, I think both approaches can succeed or fail depending on how cleverly they're implemented. So, for example, the Hawthorne Grill restaurant is used as a location in Pulp Fiction's opening and closing scenes. We get a brief shot of the exterior with the name of the place very readable. That was a real restaurant, but the movie did next to nothing in terms of promoting public awareness of its existence, and so it closed down years later. Now, I see a few product placement problems there. First of all, the exterior sign looks awful, the colours aren't appealing, and only the word grill stands out. Grill is such a vague and common usage word that its sole prominence does nothing to promote the joint. But I guess that sign was designed for visual prominence in the streets in terms of the food service on offer, not for movie product placement. Also, in the 3 seconds of screen prominence, nothing interesting is happening. There isn't the same kind of connection to characters and narrative as we get with the stuff about coffee, McDonald's, or cola brands. So the audience have no reason to think about this diner brand, whereas the fictional Jackrabbit Slim's is spoken about in the narrative. Its sign is lit in colourful neon, and the unique design themes of the place foster our curiosity. In the Hawthorne Grill, there are no logos or signs inside the restaurant that reinforce brand awareness. I assume that was an advertising mistake that they made in real life, not just it being the case in the film. No wonder they shut down. Okay, so moving on. There are times when brand names in the film are used thematically, as in they serve a point in the narrative other than just being ads. A great example is the overdose adrenaline shot scene. Two well-known board game brands are stacked together to create the phrase Operation Life. Yeah, the characters are conducting an operation to save someone's life. So in this instance, I'd say that that's probably not a paid product placement. In the pawn shop, a neon sign for the beer Killian's Red has been altered to say Kill Ed or Killed. If it's supposed to mean Kill Zed, as in Zed the Rapist, then perhaps the Zed on Zed's keys completes the phrase. Yeah, I'm not too sure about that one. I read it online and, you know, I'm 50-50 on it. But I do think that the neon letters there are deliberate, being that other props in this location, such as the Tennessee license plates and lots of clocks, all link back to Butch's family history of the gold watch heirloom. Another thematic prop is the Modesty Blaze book that's read by Vincent. Butch looks at this book after shooting Vincent, and that book tells the story of a heroine, as in female heroine, not the drug heroine, who escapes a concentration camp but then loses her memory and can't remember the camp. Remember that Butch's father died in a Vietnamese concentration camp and his buddy Captain Coons managed to escape with the watch. And then that whole concentration camp thing is sort of reenacted in the basement of the pawn shop. So this book prop isn't a product placement, I'm sure you'll agree. It's a symbolic prop. By the way, that Big Kahuna brand name seems to have symbolic meaning as well. In Hawaiian language, Kahuna has two meanings. First, a big ocean wave. So on the logo, we see a surfer with his board looking at a burger like he's going to surf it. But Kahuna also means a wise old shaman. And that's exactly what Jules is, or is becoming. The shaman implication fits with his two biblical speeches. Now come on, Rob, make your mind up. Is it product placement or narrative symbolism? Well, maybe it's both. Maybe it's neither. I'm not saying every idea I've put across in this video is conclusive. I'm just offering all these interpretations for your consideration. There seem to be lots of other brand or product placement jokes and metaphors. The casting of John Travolta, for example. At the time Pulp Fiction was made, he was a former Hollywood star, famous for the movie Grease. Grease was a 1978 film, but it was set in the 1950s, So a version of his younger self would have fitted right in as one of the Jackrabbit Slim's movie lookalike employees. I'd be amazed if Tarantino wasn't aware of that irony in picking Travolta for the role. In the same scene, Vince orders a Douglas Sirk steak. Douglas Sirk was an old-school movie director who was known for his Hollywood melodramas. And the scene itself plays as a kind of melodrama. No guns or shouting, just two people talking about emotions and their little thoughts and so on. By the way, I'd just like to mention that the use of brand names and logos for the sake of satire is legal, and it has been in the United States since well before 1990. So all the references to other movies, famous people and brands in this scene would easily fall into the fair use category. I'm not so sure about the ones to do with Coca-Cola, Burger King, Taster's Choice, Coffee and so on. Being that those brands are implied to be inferior to certain competitor brands, those companies might have had a bit of scope for legal action if they were inclined. Though the negative publicity of suing the makers of a very popular movie for product placement, that wouldn't be a very good PR move. Okay, next up I want to talk about all the accidental product and brand name placements. Now this is something that happens in every movie. Filmmakers can't help but accidentally promote things. Sometimes this consists of generalized products rather than ones associated to a designated company. So regarding foods, milkshake is strongly promoted here.
I gotta know what a $5 shake tastes like. Alright. God damn, it's a pretty fucking good milkshake.
Told you.
I don't know if it was worth $5, but it was pretty fucking good.
Every time I've watched this scene, I've felt the desire to drink a good quality milkshake. Same effect with the burger. And the gourmet coffee. And blueberry pancakes.
I'm gonna order a big plate of blueberry pancakes with maple syrup. Eggs over easy and 5 sausages.
It's a very food-orientated film and it makes me want to eat. Showing characters smoke undoubtedly triggers some smokers in the audience to want to light up too, and it could be argued that the film promotes holidays to Amsterdam and smoking pot. Brand names that are almost certainly incidental include Franzen, the brand name on the briefcase, and the Gucci logo on Mr. Wolf's watch. These are on screen so briefly they would barely register with the audience. By the way, Captain Coons mentions the company that made Butcher's family heirloom watch, but he doesn't name it. And there's no brand name on the watch in close-up. The Chevrolet sign on Vincent's car bonnet, though, is a bit more conspicuous, so it could have been a product placement, but then it kind of fits with the old-school vibe of the upcoming scene. And this scene quite simply promoted oak for bed furnishings.
I like oak myself. That's what I have in my bedroom. How about you, Jimmy? You an oak man?
Oak's nice.
That sounds like a TV commercial, doesn't it? Are you an oak man, a coke man, a royale with cheese man? It's a great slogan that could be applied to all kinds of products, the subliminal implication being that without the product you're not a man at all. It can be argued that merely mentioning or showing anything in a movie always has a product placement effect of sorts. I mean here, Jules mentions Arnold off Greenacres. I didn't know what the hell that was, so I had to go look it up and ended up watching and laughing at several clips before remembering I was researching for a film analysis video.
Arnold's doing a shopping for Fred while Doris is away. Now, let's see, we got beans, spaghetti, loaf of bread.
Pig biscuits?
They're really dog biscuits, but he don't know the difference. Anyone you want, Arnold.
And that all leads into our last topic here. I think I'll call this personally motivated product placement, which means that a filmmaker can choose, consciously or unconsciously, to promote certain products or brands because they personally like them. Tarantino is a grand master of this. The most overt one is his taste in music. He hardly ever uses original scores, instead filling his movies with old school songs that usually ones that he likes or are associated to his experiences of growing up. The soundtrack for Pulp Fiction was a very big seller. Not many movie soundtracks are that popular, and many of the songs that are featured in the movie have now become intrinsically associated culturally to Pulp Fiction, especially for younger audiences who hadn't been exposed to those songs before. Tarantino even gets a very short snippet of a song in here as incidental music from a passing groom.
It was a foot massage. A foot massage is nothing. I give my mother a foot massage.
Just laying your hands in a familiar way on myself is a new way. I mean, is it as bad as eating?
There's a photo of a jazz player in Butcher's apartment too, and a picture of some old school cars. Some of the music acts included in the film had a bit of a resurgence after the soundtrack was released, such as the power of personally motivated product placement. Kool & the Gang, for example, one of their songs is in the opening titles, and the band are name-dropped in dialogue too.
Then get the fuck out of my house before she gets here!
Hey, that's Kool & the Gang. You know, we don't want to fuck your shit up. All I want to do is call my people, get them, bring us in, that's all.
About a year and a half ago in Sacramento, a guy named John Dolenz.
Any relation to Mickey Dolenz? He was in the Monkees, it was a group. Kind of like the Beatles back
then. Shut
up! It wasn't just John Travolta who had a career revival from being in Pulp Fiction. Although the specific songs are often chosen by Tarantino because of their lyrical relevance to the scene, I'm pretty sure he has deliberately tried to keep the flame of his favourite old-school songs alive in the public mind. Without knocking the merits of Pulp Fiction, the film has a music video facet built into its structure. Interesting too that the film doesn't seem to be set in a specific year. It's like Tarantino had mixed his favoured decades of the past with the time the film was made. Jules and Vincent have 70s hairstyles, yet they use cell phones which people didn't generally have until the late 80s. I don't think Tarantino's too keen on 80s music though. He doesn't put many 80s songs in his movies, and Jules makes a direct insult here about the 80s synth-pop band Flock of Seagulls.
You, Flock of Seagulls, you know why we're here? Why don't you tell my man Vince here where you got the shit here at?
That band was from my hometown, by the way, not that I'm a fan of them either. Tarantino also does this kind of personal unpaid promotion regarding his favourite old movies. He'll take lines from his favourite classics and put them into his own scripts.
I'ma call a couple of hard pipe-hitting niggas to go to work on the homes here with a pair of pliers and a blowtorch.
That line is almost certainly a reference to the Walter Matthau crime thriller Charlie Varick. That's a great movie, by the way, so go get yourself a copy. Tarantino was always talking in interviews about his favourite old-school movies and inspirations, and he means it. A ton of them are featured in the framed posters of Jack Rabbit Slims, and his first movie, Reservoir Dogs, is considered by some to be a narrative reworking of Stanley Kubrick's film The Killing. Even the title of Pulp Fiction gives away that the movie is a collage of ideas, and I think that applies not just in terms of mixed chronology narrative structure, but in terms of musical, film and cultural references all blended into one pot. Those fonts in the opening are very 70s. Last little piece of product placement. The production company logo, A Band Apart, is in itself an advert for Tarantino's first movie, Reservoir Dogs, which wasn't a hit in America until after people saw Pulp Fiction, then went looking for his previous film. Over here in Britain, though, Reservoir Dogs was an instant big hit in its own right. Oh, note the musical connection there too. A Band Apart, is a group of people we associate with making music. Tarantino also strongly promoted himself in the film too. I know he's taken some flack for not being the movie star type, but in Pulp Fiction I thought he cast himself very well and acted the part competently. It wasn't a sore thumb cameo as we'd expect. So the film made him a star director by name and by appearance. Most other directors are primarily famous by name only. It's kind of like Hitchcock, who promoted himself by making cameo appearances in his own movies and became one of the first household name directors. So, all kinds of product placement dynamics in Pulp Fiction, and instead of it being tedious stuff that distracts from the narrative, it's seamlessly worked into the film at a base entertainment level. I can't think of many movies that pull off that kind of product placement so well. Actually, that method of working products into a story so that they become part of the narrative is much more commonplace and sophisticated today in the age of the internet. Tons of the videos you watch and share on social media are sponsored by brand name companies, with their products weaved into the narrative in little ingenious ways. You've been listening to Rob Ager. This video you've been watching is the second in a series on product placement. So if you haven't seen the first one, which I did a couple of weeks ago and was all about the movie Total Recall, then go check that one out. Whenever you're fascinated by a movie and want a refreshing, cool analysis of it, think Rob Ager. Think CollativeLearning.com.